had an uncle that had it real bad, and it's kind of inherited, I guess. I don't know what else. So.
Tell me about Aunt Hazel.
Well, Aunt Hazel was married to my Uncle Earl, who was a preacher. And times was really, really hard then, but they'd go from church to church, and people would give them money or give them things. And so they were kind of better off than the rest of the family was. And she kind of acted like she was about three notches above the rest of us. And of course, none of us really liked that. And then she had a daughter named, she had a daughter and a son and a daughter, and the youngest daughter was really, I mean, really spoiled rotten. She was ugly.
What made you decide to open up a restaurant?
Well, it really wasn't my choice. Your grandpa, my husband, went down and bought a little old joint by the side of the Saddle Club, and it was just a counter with about five or six stools around it. And when we first got it, I hadn't ate in a cafe or we couldn't afford to, and I was plumb beside myself on what to do and how to do it. And even had one man come in and help me, show me how to clean the grill. And we kind of outgrew that and moved up the street, Faye, when we got that. Well, we kind of outgrew that little joint to the side of the Saddle Club and moved up the street in a building. And then we kind of outgrew that, so we moved over where the library is now. And we had booths and had a pretty good business. And I worked down there a lot. And then Grandpa Miller, and Grandma Miller took care of Donnie. He was about, what, two?
Yeah.
And
barely two.
So one day, my husband came home, told me he had sold the cafe. He didn't even ask me anything about it or anything. He got $25,000 and they thought he was rich. And so anyway, we went from there to yonder. I went to Moreland, drove to Moreland for about 6 months and operated the cafe over there, which we leased. And then after that, they built the cafe. And in the deal, he made an agreement with that guy. We wouldn't go in business against him when he bought the cafe. Well, after driving to Moreland, then they decided to build this cafe that we recently owned outside the city limits. And I was very, very concerned about people driving out there to eat. And when they was fixing the kitchen, they had the grill by the window and whatnot, and they had a gas pipe running to the grill, and I told them to leave the grill far enough back of the counter where I could run over there and wash dishes when we weren't busy. Well, when it got all said and done, they had the gas pipe up about 2 feet off the floor, so that eliminated me running through there washing dishes. But I kind of figured that we wouldn't have a lot of business and I'd have to do my own dishes. But it grew into quite a business. Oh, quite a while before we put the cafe out there. In fact, they built a storm cellar out there, which the Miller family was, or Grandma and Grandpa was very scared of storms, and we built that storm out there, and a cellar out there, and it was loose sand and all this and that and the other. And one night we went out there to the storm. Of course, they had electricity to it, and it was raining, and the water was running down through the sand through the electric plugs, and you remember that? I don't suppose you do.
Mm-hmm. I don't really know.
And it was pretty scary. But anyway, the boys, Larry especially, down in the back part, developed rodeo ground, put up lights, and they spent a lot of time out there with the horses and with the horse and the calves. And
how were women generally treated in the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s compared to now?
Oh, they were expected to do much more than they are now. They used to cook and wash and take care of the kids, and I don't know that they were ever really disrespected, but.
Did you ever have any independence?
Me?
Yeah.
Not really.
Do you think that not being allowed to have that independence is not really respect?
You what?
Do you think it's disrespectful not to give women independence or
to let them... Well, it kind of depends on the situation a little bit. I can't say that I really didn't have any independence, but I know a lot of the things I did and managed was under Hook's control, and I know I planned many things to keep peace in the family, and I used to tell the kids that not to argue with their dad because he was pretty bullheaded, and I'd tell them to listen and then go do what they want to, so.
That a girl.
But they argued with him. It made him all the more stubborn. And you remember that?
Oh, God, yes. I remember that. I never tell my dad. He liked to see things get done just as long as he wasn't the one that had to do it.
I mean, he got way off center before he died, too. We had a doctor that was here and went down to Weatherford, I think. We took him down there one time. He put him on some kind of a pill. I don't remember what it was. And he gave him a horse's dose of it. And he was hard to live with. He'd get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. He'd think the boys ought to get up and go do work. And they finally wound up taking him up to Kansas. Would you go that time?
I think so.
Anyway, most of the kids went with him, but, well, you might not have been there, because I know one of the issues was about your hair, you know, mm-hmm. when they was kind of letting her hair grow, he was bound, he's had a fit about you not cutting your hair, and so, we went up there to that doctor, psychologist, whatever he was that day, and, of course, the kids were all there, and he tried to tell the doctor that I was the crazy one, that he wasn't. And so, when it was all said and done, the doctor told the kids, well, they better watch him because he was pretty risky. Keep the knives and all that stuff out of his way. But he swore him down that I was the crazy one. And
lay pretty low. So my senior year in high school was pretty rough year. I mean, I didn't know my dad anymore because I don't even think he knew himself. He was, he got to be where he had to be pretty heavily medicated. And that's one of the things I always regretted, becoming a man and not knowing my father as a man. I only knew him as a pre-adolescent and when he was himself, but I never got to know him as a man, and I've always regretted that.
So growing up with a father who was unstable in the later part of his life, do you feel like that inspired you to be the father that you never had?
Well, yeah, I think in a way it did. You know, you always look back on things that might have affected your life or changed your life in some way, and you really never get as much thought until you have kids your own. But I really honestly think that my dad and I had a pretty adversarial relationship, and when I was trying to form my own opinions about who I was and where I was headed, and for a long time, especially in my years in college, I was wild and rebellious, and I think it was a lot had to do with not having, you know, a father figure who I could rely on for advice and guidance. And you know, and mom, she was always working all the time, but I knew my dad loved me. I never had any thoughts or questions about that. It was just a period in my life where, you know, you're transcending from going to a young adult into a young man, and not having a father there that could interact with you in a way and give you advice, and it was pretty tough. It was, and I swore I'd never be that person to my kids. I would always be there for my kids, and I'd always try to, you know, give them advice when they sought it. And when I saw them doing something I thought was wrong, I'd always try to not tell them no. I would always try to lead them in a different direction. So, yeah, in a sense, it did. It really, it kind of impacted my life. And I think it, you know, although it was tough on me, I think it made me a better father. He really didn't have any kind of a formal education. I think he might have went to maybe the sixth grade. But
no, he didn't go that far.
Well, not even a sixth grade education. But his wisdom came through life, and you know, even though he wasn't very well educated at all, he was a very this is the time when he was, before he got, you know, he became kind of got into a period of life where he kind of lost his mind a little bit. But what I do remember of him, I mean, he was very intelligent. I remember one time he was very witty. Some guy owed him some money, and my dad would follow somebody to the ends of the earth to collect a debt, you know, and he was really persistent about it. But I guess he got a little too persistent with one guy at the restaurant up there one day, and the guy told him that he was going to whip his ass. And my dad didn't bat an eye. He looked him straight in the eye and said, "Well, I can't stop you from trying, but I'll damn sure break you the habit." And I really thought about that a lot, you know, going on, and that came from him. I mean, that was his wit, and but he was a man of life. I mean, everything he learned came through his interaction with other people with life, and you know, he was a really decent man, you know, but he was also he was very stubborn, very demanding of everybody, and he was not one to realize his own faults very quickly at all, and he really resented when you brought something out that you thought was wrong. But anyway, we all came out fine. I mean, I have five older brothers and a great sister, and you know, all of us turned out great. And I think it had a lot to do with mom being there for us. You know, she raised. She raised seven children, and I can honestly say I don't ever remember her missing any event that I took place in school. She went to all my ball games, and she was the rock for all of us, and still is. You know, she's an inspiration. She's a very strong woman.
And now I'll tell you that story.
Yeah, I gambled a bunch of money away.
Yeah. Went up there over the weekend. We always paid our help with cash we had. We paid on Monday. And I was gone over the weekend. Well, when I came back, we didn't have any money to pay with. And we had to write checks out of the bank to pay the help. So I asked one of the cooks, I said, "Well, didn't you guys have any business this weekend?" She said, "We had a big weekend." So the money went fishing, but I never did know. But I'd have no idea how much money he lost in that deal. And he liked to gamble. He liked to bet on horses, and he liked to go to the pool hall and play pitch. And a lot of times of the evening when he came home from work, him and Albie both would stop at the pool hall and get home whenever they felt like coming home. But one thing about Hook was that he always cared where his kids were at or what they were doing, and Albie let his run all over town, and a lot of times he'd come home at night and be out looking for them, see where they're at. And he always pretty much made the kids stay at home and play. And they'd have kids over and whatnot, but they didn't dare get out and run around.